Welcome to Stem Cell Transplant Patient and Caregiver class. My name's Callie. I'm a nurse here at CBCI. I've been here about 13 years. And we always introduce ourselves that way because we like you to know that we've been doing this for a while. Basically today, this class is going to provide an overview of the transplant process, from concepts to pre-transplant information, inpatient expectations, post-transplant, and caregiver information. Something that we do like people to know is that this is an overview. So something that's important is that hands-on teaching is going to be done hands-on. So for instance, people are going to have special IVs and different things that go on with them, and we want you to know that this class is not about that. It is just giving you an overview of this process. So first of all, we really start at the basics, with the basics, even though you've probably talked about those with your doctor, with your coordinator, with different staff members, just what is a transplant. But we like to start with the basics. So what are stem cells? Stem cells are immature blood cells that develop into red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, and an immune system. And we can find stem cells pretty much anywhere in our bodies, but we are really specifically talking about hematologic or stem cells of the marrow or blood, okay? So where do we find those? We find them in the marrow. So everybody who, many of the patients who are viewing this video are going to say, yes, I've had a bone marrow biopsy. And that's one of the ways that we pull out cells, and we can look at the marrow and we can see what's going on in there. Another place we get stem cells are from peripheral blood, and we call that circulating blood. So if someone takes blood from your arm, that's circulating blood. And a third place that we can find stem cells is from umbilical cord blood. I always like to tell people that, you know, when we talk about umbilical cord blood, we are not talking about, you know, anything besides full-term babies whose parents have very kindly donated those umbilical cords to be processed and cryopreserved, frozen, for use by people who need them, people who might have one of these malignancies that need a transplant. So something we like to go over is the actual stem cell growth diagram. And I really love this picture. And the reason I love this picture is over on the far left, okay, you see pluripotent stem cells, okay? And then you see them do all sorts of things. So pretend that this is marrow, but I kind of call it the garden of marrow because over on the far left, you have your seeds, okay? And those are pluripotent stem cells. And their job is to differentiate or grow into different types of cells, okay, that are going to help your body function. The myeloid cells go through a whole bunch of processes, but eventually they spit out platelets, which are your clotting cells. So if you cut yourself, your platelets would rush to that spot and form a scab and stop you from bleeding, okay? And that happens in a lot more sophisticated ways as well, but that's a really simple way of explaining it. The other things that the myeloid cells produce are red blood cells, so hemoglobin and hematocrit. So hemoglobin carries oxygen to all of your vital organs, your brain, very important, your lungs, your heart. So we need those. And then white blood cells, and there's a whole bunch of different types of white blood cells. And white blood cells get signals from your body, from the immune system saying, hey, there's somebody in here who's not working very well. We need you to go and take care of things, right? You have a bacteria or you have a virus or you have a fungal infection, and your body's going to respond to that and try to fight it off, okay? So the other branch of this is lymphoid stem cells. And this line differentiates into T cells and B cells and plasma cells, which is the immune system. We talk about the immune system a lot in BMT transplant because it's part of the whole process of transplant. Is you're here because, or you're listening to this because you are having an allogeneic stem cell transplant, which means you're getting cells from a donor. So if we're repopulating this garden you have of marrow, we're putting these new seeds in, these new pluripotent stem cells, and we're getting those white blood cells, red blood cells, platelets, but we're getting this new immune system as well. And that's super important to transplant because you need a new gatekeeper on your immune system. You want an immune system that is going to essentially identify cells that shouldn't be there and create an immune response that gets rid of them. Okay, but we're going to talk more about that as we move on. So what is a stem cell transplant? Some people think of transplant and they think, oh gosh, you know, I'm going to have this process done. It's going to be a surgery. And we always like to reassure people it's not a surgery. This is all done through the circulating blood. In the case of actually receiving cells back, they're given through a central line, through a special IV that's placed in the chest, and they're dripped in like a blood transfusion. It can be a little bit different for donors, and we'll talk about that more as we move on. But these cells are dripped in, like I said, just like a blood transfusion or a platelet transfusion, and they go into your circulating blood, and then they find their niche. They refine the marrow, not all of them, but a lot of them, enough to repopulate the marrow and grow new cells. And again, we keep talking about, you know, growing new cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, and a new immune system. So we do kind of talk about different types of transplant in here, but only to kind of give you an idea of what the types are. So we have autologous stem cell transplant, which is getting your own cells. Some people are having an allogeneic transplant, which is why you're viewing this class, have had an autologous stem cell transplant. They've gotten their own stem cells, and that was kind of a treatment that occurred before this allogeneic stem cell transplant of getting someone else's cells. So we're not really going to talk much about that. An allogeneic transplant, as we were talking about, is getting someone else's cells. And those cells can be donated by family members, unrelated donors from the national or international donor program, or umbilical cord donations. The last one is the syngeneic transplant, which is using twin cells. We don't do that as much, just because a twin cell's immune system could match the other twin's much too identically and be more difficult to get an immune response that we want, a new gatekeeper. When I talk about this, I always like to say that one of the amazing things about transplant is that all of these types are volunteer. Of course, auto, you're giving your own cells, so you're definitely volunteering for that. But getting cells from someone else, it's a family member donating. Or, and it could that could be a child or a parent, depending on what we're doing. Unrelated donors, those are volunteers. There are about 25 million people who are registered around the world to be donors. Okay, so that means 25 million people were willing to be a donor, which I always think is kind of a neat thing to think about. And same with the umbilical cord donations is, again, those were volunteer. So, and even in some cases, you know, when we're bringing those cells from another country or another place in the U.S. or wherever they may be, oftentimes the couriers are also volunteers. They're specially trained to bring those cells in. And it's just, it's kind of neat that that's how this works. So we kind of go back to basics here, finding a donor. If you're watching this video, you're probably well aware that we've done some special testing on you. The reason that we're getting the blood or the swab from the cheek, it's called a buccal swab, is that we want to look at essentially a picture of your DNA. And a lot of us refer to that as a fingerprint of your DNA. We want to see what makes you you. We don't look at every single characteristic. You know, you hear about genotyping and these extended tests. We're looking at 10 markers that are pertinent to this situation, okay? And those 10 markers, and sometimes a few more than that, will show us what enough of what your immune system looks like that we can look for a donor that could potentially match you. So, if you have family members that we think could be potential donors for you, we will swab them as well. Most often we look at siblings. That said, things are changing rapidly. And we also at times look at children, not young children, but children over 18 years of age typically, or siblings that aren't full donors or parents. So when we look at these markers on families, our ideal would be a sibling with the same mom, the same dad, and they match it 10 markers, right? We look at those 10 markers and we say, oh, that's a 10 out of 10 match. And so for us, that's a match, okay? We also run a search at the same time in the national registry that I just spoke about, and we look for potential matches there. So it's kind of amazing because occasionally you'll run it through the system and find many, many, many potential matches out there in the world. Sometimes people have more unique fingerprints, and you may find 3 potential matches out of that 25 million people, right? Or you may find 1, or you may find someone who's not a perfect match for you, and very, very occasionally you don't find a match. One of the reasons that we've changed some of the things that we do for finding donors and using donors is because of those potentials of not finding donors that were a 10 out of 10 match. There have been multiple studies done over many, many years of the optimal donor to use. And the 10 out of 10 match sibling donor is still our first preference, as long as that donor is healthy. Okay, there's a lot of caveats. But we're also now able to use patients' family members who are half matches if needed. If there is a potential 10 out of 10, remember we're matching up those 10 markers in the registry, then we may use that donor. And then if we can't find any of those, we may use umbilical cord. And occasionally we'll use it for different reasons, but we're not going to go into those here. So if your donor is related to you and they're going to be the one who gives you their stem cells, okay, they're going to come here to Denver and work with a special donor coordinator, okay, who will work with them specifically to get testing done and to make sure that this is going to be a safe donation here at CPCI PSL, okay? If your donor is not related to you, they will work through the National Marrow Donor Program through Be the Match, and they will have a coordinator wherever that may be. You know, maybe your donor is in New York City and they'll be worked up at Sloan Kettering with an NMDP donor center. Something I do like to say is that we are a National Marrow Donor Center. So we are the people here in Denver also who, if someone in Tucson, Arizona needs a transplant and they identify the donor, the unrelated donor, anonymous, okay, here in Denver, then our team would work with getting them scheduled, making sure they were safe for donation, making sure it's safe for the donor and for the patient to receive their cells, and then arranging for the courier to take those cells to Tucson. So this is very much a communal effort. A donor could be in London, and the person in London is going to do the same thing, or in lots of different parts of the world.